Yeah, g'day guys. Mark here. Welcome back to my channel. Now, if you've been following closely, you'd know that a month ago I bought a Nikken 150 CNC rotary table for my milling machine. I haven't needed to use it yet, but once I do, it's going to be much more convenient if I make up some adapters to adapt its flange to the tool holding I've already got for my lathe. So I think I'll start today by making up the collet closer to use my B32 collets on the rotary table. My Schaublin 125 CNC lathe's spindle has a native D13 cam lock nose, so I'd like to be able to use those chucks and other tool holding directly on the rotary table. And the inside of the Schaublin spindle is ground for B32 collets. They're similar in size to 5C, but of course different. As implied by the name, these are 32mm outer diameter collets, but the weird thing is this thread. As you can see, it's a sawtooth shaped thread. It's called a buttress thread, and it's also a very weird size. Now, why do we use buttress threads? If I can remember rightly, they're used for threads that only have to transmit power in one direction. I had a bit of a look around, and I think the only other buttress thread I've got in my workshop, it's this one that's currently guarded by my puk-puk, which is Papua New Guinean for crocodile. It's a carving my dad brought back from a business trip to PNG probably 30 years ago, maybe longer. But anyway, what was I saying? Oh yeah. So here you can see that record used a buttress thread for the spindle of this woodworking vise. I wasn't sure if there might not be some other advantages to buttress threads, so I googled it. And sure enough, there are. One thing about that I never understood was, if buttress threads are the best ones for carrying a load in only one direction, why aren't they used on all screws? Because most screws and bolts are only used to tighten. If you've got an opinion on that, please put it in the comments section. I'd like to hear it. Now, to mount these B32 collets, I'm going to need two parts. On the front, I'm going to need an adapter with the taper that slots into this 6cm hole. I drew that up in Onshape, but we'll make that next week. The second part needed is a draw tube which goes in the back through this 40mm through hole and has the threads to pull the collets closed. Now, I modelled this as a single piece, but they had this drop of thick walled tubing at the steel suppliers and it's just about perfect. So what I'll do is make the draw tube out of two pieces. That'll allow me to cut this off quite short and chuck it up nice and close to the end of the chuck for cutting that thread. And once that's done, I'll turn a flange for the back end of it and shrink fit and probably weld it into position. Now, to cut that inside buttress thread, I've got this broken piece of carbide mounted in a boring bar. It's already got the 45 degree angle on this side. It must be reasonably close to the 5 degree angle along this side, so I'll use this. Whenever I'm grinding carbide, in addition to the vacuum, I also have a proper particle mask on. But this first operation is just going to be splitting the carbide in half. Splitting carbide, like this 8mm in half, is kind of the worst part of tool grinding. The Clarkson Mark 1 tool and cutter grinder, having a pretty limited top slide travel, means that you have to do a lot of reconfiguration between each different angle you want to grind onto a tool. But luckily most of the accessories are somewhat asymmetric, so switching them around often makes space or gives you clearance that you wouldn't otherwise get. Now, whoops, I forgot to put a couple of degrees of back clearance on there. Now for the last grind, I'm going to need to flip the wheel around. I mean, I could grind this upside down, but with carbide, you need the wheel to go into the cutting edge and not out of it, otherwise it breaks out. Because I can't reverse the spindle direction on this, it's easiest just to flip the wheel around. So how does that look? That's going to work okay. I'm not sure if that's perfect, but we'll cut one and see how it goes. Mail time. I sent a request out to my Patreons and members asking if anyone had a way of getting a mil-spec connector because RS wouldn't deliver to private people here in Austria. Well, it turns out they must have changed this system because Jordan from Canada managed to order this for direct delivery. So thank you very much for doing that, Jordan. This is the connector that I need to mount onto my Maho milling machine because I've already got the matching cable from Nikken, which connects to the fourth axis, which I bought. And this one's set up for solder, which is perfect. Thanks very much, Jordan. I really appreciate that. I also got a package from Henrik in Sweden because Henrik found in his stash this connector, which is exactly the one which is damaged on my Nikken. Oh wow, and he sent me its part number as well. That's fantastic, Henrik. Really appreciate that. Once again, it's a solder one, so that's going to be easy to sort out. And it's the bycatch here. Oh nice. It's that an M12 Kenner metal. It's that looks like a carbide drill. Nice little 6-flute end mill. Guess that's for cutting hard materials. And another carbide end mill. This looks like probably 10 millimeter. Nope, 8. Nice. Thank you very much, Henrik. At this point, I'm not sure whether I'm going to install that just to fix the existing controller or whether I use this as part of the switch to integrating the Nikken fourth axis directly into Linux CNC so I can run it as a full 4D contouring system. One of the best things about building a community around a channel is that if I ask a technical question, I'll get easily 10 good answers, but one will just be the perfect one. Now in this case, I had the problem of the missing oil sight glass for my Nikken, so I kind of asked where can I find these sort of things, and I was put on to Dold Mechatronic. They had a web shop, so I'm pretty sure this is the perfect oil sight glass for that machine. So a big thank you to Gregor for putting me onto Dold Mechatronic, who sold it to me. Right, well that's some pretty horrible swarf, but it still seems to leave a pretty nice looking surface finish, so that's good. I should have used a shorter boring bar. That was obviously too much stick out. Got a fair bit of chatter there. The tool still looks nice and sharp, hasn't chipped, so that's a good sign. I think at this stage the thread's still too tight. Yep, need to open it up a little more. Now, while I'd like to say that I realized that something was going wrong here, I didn't. I just kept increasing the diameter over and over and over again until it fit. I must have run this whole toolpath at least 10 times. I even congratulated myself on the fact that by running this toolpath with small incremental changes, I got rid of the chatter. Woohoo! I took a few more passes to clean up that thread and bring it up to dimension, but that was good because it also took away any chatter. Now it's reasonably loose, but for this sort of job, I'm hoping it's going to work well enough. Not the cleanest thread I've ever made, but let's hope it works. Right, to make the flange, I'll just cut off a piece of scrap steel. Now in the edit, this seems almost like a Python-esque rejection of reality to see me forging ahead like this. Right, gonna need to poke a hole through this. So let's start with a center drill. So the final hole is about 35 millimeters. So I can take it out a bit further with a bigger drill. Right, interference fit, that's what I want. Just put a chamfer on there. Right, let's see how hot I'm going to need to get this to be able to put these two parts together. Okay, so that's my zero. It's not terribly round, this metal. About fourth hour out. Let's take a look at the bore. So about 0.14 of a millimeter. So if I put that into the thermal expansion calculator, I'm going to need probably about 320 degrees Celsius to get a sliding fit. But you always want a bit of margin, so I'll take it up to 400 degrees to give that a good chance of slipping together. Right, well that's warming up. I'll just quickly chop the ears off this. Okay, temperature's now up at about 410, so that should be hot enough, I'd say. You really only get one chance at this sort of thing. Ah, that went in nicely. Fantastic. Didn't need either of the hammers. Right, next day, it's nice and cold. I'll just put a bit of weld on that. Now this is probably boots and suspenders, but we'll be right back. Well, considering I haven't done any TIG for a while, I'm actually reasonably happy with that weld. Just leave that to cool down for a while. That weld cleaned up really nicely. Let's add a chamfer. And now the inner chamfer. I'm glad I bought a left-hand VCMT tool holder at some stage. But that's now done up to the point where I just need to put the wrenching slots on it. Now, call me a slow learner, but it's taken me a couple of days to realize I screwed up this thread. I've never cut a thread with asymmetric flanks before. I think you saw the way I offered up the thread cutter into the existing threads to see if they fit or not. Okay, so what did I do? Well, I made a tool that fits in there, but then I'm cutting on that side. So if we take a look, this is our collet. So you can see it's got teeth like this. But on the other side, of course, it's the opposite. So I made a tool that fit in here. This out here would be the draw tube. And as you can see, the tool I needed was the one to cut those slots. Oh, that was pretty darn lame. I guess I got a little lucky in that this piece of tube, which I picked up in the drops of the metal dealer, was long enough that I do have a second piece, so I can take a second shot at it. But I am going to have to grind up the opposite tool, and I'm out of time for that now. So it's going to be next week before I get a chance to make the replacement pull tube. And yeah, duh. See you next week. Thanks for watching.